Cambridge IGCSE, October-November 2019, Paper 43. Question 1, Figure 1.1 is the top view of a tank in an aquarium. The tank is filled with salt water. The depth of the water in the tank is 2 meter. Part A, calculate the volume of the water in the tank. So we have a tank here and the top view of the tank is given in the figure. Height or the depth of the tank is 2 meter. So depth means its height, which is not given in the figure as it contains only the top view. So this length is its height or depth, which is 2 meter. In order to calculate the volume, we can consider this tank as two cuboids. The first one, the rectangular top view as shown in this part, and the second cuboid we can consider by taking the other part. Now we can find the volume using the equation of the volume of a cuboid, that is length into breadth into height. And we have two cuboids, this is the first one and this is the second one. And for the first one we have the length L1 and breadth we can consider as B1, and height is the depth, which is 2 meter. For the second cuboid also we have length, which we can represent it with L2, and breadth B2, and height again as it's common we can use same letter or H1 H2, that is 2 meter. So we can find the volume separately and we can find the sum. So the volume where it will be equal to L1 B1 H1 plus L2 B2 H2. And we can substitute the value for the first cuboid. The length is 1.6, breadth is 1.1, and height is 2. For the second cuboid, the length is 3.2 times B2 is 1 times height is again 2. And the answer is 9.9, as its volume, the unit is meter cube. So 9.9 meter cube. Part B, the density of water in the tank is 1.1 into 10 to the power 3 kilogram per meter cube. Calculate the mass of the water in the volume. So we need to calculate mass. We have density and volume. So we can use the equation of density, that is mass over volume. In order to calculate mass, we can make mass as a subject. So we will get mass is equal to density times volume, where density is 1.1 into 10 to the power 3 and volume we have calculated in the first part, 9.9. So we will get 1.1 into times 10 to the power 4 Pascal. So that is, sorry, kilogram, since it is mass. So that is mass into SF, 1.1 times 10 to the power 4 kilogram. Going to part C, calculate the pressure due to the water at the level of 0.8 meter above the base of the tank. So the length here is given 0.80 meter above the base of the tank. So we have a tank with height 2 meter and the tank is filled with water. Now we need to measure the pressure of the water at somewhere where the depth is 0.80 meter above from the base. So here we need to calculate the pressure in fluid and we can use the equation, pressure is rho gh, density times g times height, where height is the depth of the water level, that is this height. So we can find this by substituting the total depth of the water minus 0.80 and we will get 1.2 meter. So the depth of the water level is 1.2 meter. As it's mentioned, this level is 0.80 meter above the base of the tank. Now we can substitute the values density, which we have calculated in the previous session. Sorry, which is already given in part B, that is 1.1 into 10 to the power 3. So we can substitute 1.1 times 10 to the power 3 times G value is constant, gravitational field strength, that is 10 always, and height is 1.2 meter. So we'll get 1.4 times 10 to the power 4. Sorry, 1.3 times 10 to the power 4 Pascal. The unit of pressure is Pascal. So 1.3 times 10 to the power 4 Pascal. This is a 3-mark question, and 1 mark belongs to calculating the height of this water level by subtracting the total height minus 0.80. We will get 1 mark. And for writing the equation and substitution part, the other mark, and the final mark is for writing the final answer with unit. Going to part 2. Question 2, part A, state in words the equation that defines the moment of a force. So we should write the equation of moment in words. So the equation of moment is equal to force times perpendicular distance from the pivot, where force times perpendicular distance, these are the keywords. Part 2, state what is meant by the moment of a force. So moment of a force is nothing but the turning effect of a force. So we can write turning effect of a force is moment of a force, and since it is 1 mark question, 1 point is enough. Part 3, force is a vector quantity. Explain what is meant by the term vector. So vector is a quantity that has both magnitude and direction. Part B, figure 2.1 shows a tower crane used to lift a load on a construction site. Explain how the counterweight prevents the crane from toppling over. So as seen in this figure, a crane is used to lift the load, but in order to balance, we have to use another counterweight at the other side. Then only the crane will be balanced so that we can prevent the crane from toppling over. So when you add this counterweight, basically the counterweight provides an anti-clockwise moment. So which will be balanced with the clockwise moment from the load. So the crane will be balanced. This is the basic principle. So we can write counterweight provides anti-clockwise moment, and the clockwise moment will be equal to anti-clockwise moment. So the resultant turning effect is zero, or it's balanced. Since it is 2-mark question, you should write 2 points, and counterweight provides anti-clockwise moment is important, and clockwise moment and anti-clockwise moment will be zero in this case. This is also important keyword. Question 3, part A. Figure 3.1 shows a waterfall. Describe the main energy transfer which is taking place as the water falls. So we know that when the water is at the top, because of its position or because of its height from the ground, it will have gravitational potential energy. While it falling downwards, its speed will increase, so that kinetic energy will increase. So at the top, potential energy will be high. When it falling downwards, its potential energy will reduce as the height reduces, but as the speed increases, its kinetic energy will increase. So here the energy transfer is from potential energy to kinetic energy. So we can write from gravitational potential energy to kinetic energy. Part 2, the speed of the water as it hits the bottom is 21 meter per second. Calculate the height of the waterfall. So here we can consider the all the its gravitational potential energy will be converted to kinetic energy when the water reaches at the bottom. So we can equate the gravitational potential energy at the top will be equal to the kinetic energy at the bottom. So we can write mgh, which is the gravitational potential energy at the top, is equal to kinetic energy at bottom. So initially we can write the gravitational potential energy lost will be equal to the kinetic energy gained, where potential energy equation mgh and kinetic energy equation half mv square. The mass of the water which is falling is not given, but as the mass is common at both sides, we can cancel. So you will get g times h is equal to half v square, where v value is given, g is 10. So we can calculate height. So we can make height as the subject. So we will get half v square over g. G will come to the denominator at the RHS. We can substitute the values. Half times speed is 21, which we have to square, over g value is gravitational constant, which is 10. So we will get 22.05, and into SF we can write 22 meter. Part 3, state and explain any assumption you made in part 2. So in part 2, when we were calculating, we have considered that all the lost gravitational potential energy converted to kinetic energy, not converted to any other form of energy. So this is an assumption we have made, that all gravitational potential energy converted only to kinetic energy, not to thermal energy, or no energy lost. So we can write down the assumption, no energy lost to surroundings. Part B, the sun is the source of energy for most energy resources used to produce electricity. State two energy resources that have another source for their energy. So we just need to write energy resource which is not depending on sun. So here you can write down geothermal and nuclear. Question number 4. Solids have a fixed shape. Liquids adapt to the shape of their container. Gases fill their container. Explain in terms of forces between molecules and arrangement of molecules why solids, liquid and gases have these properties. So you should use the concept of the forces between the molecules in the solids, liquid and gases. How this is differ in three different states. So when we consider a solid, we can see the molecules arranged in a lattice manner, or the molecules are tightly packed. There is no space between the molecules, and it's because of the bond between the molecules, or the force between the molecules are very strong. But when you consider liquid, there is small space in between the molecules because the molecules are not in fixed place. So the reason for this is the force between the molecules are weak. So the force is not enough to hold these molecules in a fixed place. But when we look at the molecules of gas, we can see the molecules are far apart. And the reason is no forces between the molecules. So for solids, we have to write 2 points. So we can write down molecules in lattice arrangement as the forces between the molecules are strong. Here the lattice arrangement is the keyword, and strong forces also an important word. You should include these points in order to score 2 marks. Now going to liquid, we can write molecules not fixed in place as the forces between the molecules are too weak. Now going to gases, First point we can write, molecules are far apart as no forces between the molecules. So it's a 6-mark question. We have written 2 points for each solid, liquid and gases. So that's enough to score full mark. Going to question number 5. An electric kettle contains water at a temperature of 19 degrees Celsius. The kettle has power rating 3 kilowatt and is switched on for 3.5 minutes. Calculate the energy supplied to the kettle by the electricity supply. So here the temperature is given, the power of the kettle is given and the time is given, and you need to calculate energy. So here we can use the equation which relates power, energy and time. As we know, power is rate of change of energy. So in order to calculate energy, we can make energy as a subject. So energy is the product of power and time, where power is 3 kilowatt. Kilo means 10 to the power 3. Times time is 3.5 minutes. Minutes we should convert to seconds. So we should multiply it with 60. And the answer is 630,000 joule. We should write the answer in 2SF. Part B. At 3.5 minutes, the temperature of the water reaches 100 degrees Celsius. The volume of the water in the kettle is 1700 centimeter cube and its density is 1 gram per centimeter cube. The specific heat capacity of water is 4200 joule per kg degree Celsius. Calculate the thermal energy gained by the water. So when the kettle was working for 3.5 minutes, its temperature has changed from 19 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius. So there is a change in temperature, that is from 19 degrees Celsius to 100 degrees Celsius. The volume of the water is given, density is also given, and specific heat capacity C is also given. We need to calculate energy. So in order to calculate energy, we can use the equation. Energy is mass times specific heat capacity times change in temperature. But we don't have mass. But we can use the equation of density is mass over volume. From this, mass is density. So we will get mass is density times volume. So in this equation, instead of mass, we can write density times volume. That is nothing but mass times specific heat capacity times change in temperature. So we will get density is 1 times volume is 1700. But we will get this mass in grams. But we should convert into kilogram, because kilogram is the standard unit of mass. So you should multiply times 10 to the power minus 3, because the conversion from gram to kilogram is by multiplying with 10 to the power minus 3 or by dividing with 1000. Both are same. So here the value, the mass which I calculated by multiplying the density and volume, is in gram. So we need to convert gram into kilogram. So you can use this conversion. Gram into kilogram is the, we can gain by multiplying with 10 to the power minus 3 or dividing with 1000. So now I have converted into kilogram and specific heat capacity is given. That is 4200 times change in temperature. That is from 19 degree to 100 degree. So we should find how much temperature has increased by subtracting the initial and final temperatures. So we will get 1 times 1700 times 10 to the power minus 3 times 4200 times 81. And the answer is 580,000 580,000 joule as its energy, the unit is joule. Part C, calculate the efficiency of the kettle. So we have calculated the output energy or the thermal energy, that is the output energy of the kettle, and the total electrical energy, that is the input energy of the kettle, both we have. So we have the total input energy and the useful output energy. In order to calculate the efficiency, the equation of efficiency is equal to useful energy output over total energy input times 100, where useful energy output, which we just calculated in the previous session, over total input energy, that is the electrical energy giving to the kettle, which we have calculated in the first part, that is 630,000 times 100, and the answer is 92%. Question number 6. Figure 6.1 represents wavefronts of a sound wave traveling in air from left to right. So this is the figure of a sound wave which is traveling from left to right in this direction. State the name given to the region around A in the diagram, region around B in the diagram. So we know that the sound wave consists of compressions and rarefactions. So the regions where the particles are close together are called compressions. So point A belongs to a region of compression. So here we can write region around A is in the diagram is compression, and the region around B, as we can see, there are less particles around B, and this region where the particles are more apart or further apart are known as rarefactions. So here we can write rarefaction. Part B, on figure 6.1, draw a double headed arrow to show one wavelength. So in sound wave, one wavelength is the distance between a compression to another compression. It's because we can represent it as a wave where the compressions will always have peaks or crust, and rarefaction we can always represent as a trough. So this is how we can consider a sound waves, where compression should always represented by a crust and rarefaction should always represent by troughs. So now it will be easy to understand a wavelength, because the wavelength is the distance between a crust to crust. So this length represent one wavelength, and it should be a double headed arrow. So if for a sound wave, always understand the wavelength is represented by the distance between two consecutive compressions. So this distance represent one wavelength. Part C, the loudness of the sound increases as the same pitch. State and explain any change there would be in the pattern of wavefronts shown in 6.1. So here the loudness of the sound increases, but the pitch still maintain as the same value. So what will happen to this sound wave? So here we should understand that the pitch is same. As the pitch is same, the frequency must be same. So frequency is not changing, but the loudness increases, and when the loudness increases, the amplitude of a wave will increase. So we should know that the relation between loudness and amplitude. Whenever the amplitude of a wave increases, its loudness will increase. So in this question, loudness increases, that means we can understand the amplitude increases, but nothing happened to the wavelength, because wavelength does not depend on the loudness. So the wavelength will be still same as the previous value, but amplitude will increase. Amplitude means the crust, height of the crust and trough will increase. So crust is represented with a compression, where higher amplitude or higher crust means the compression will be high. That means more compressions will be there, or particle will be further more closer in this region. Whereas in rarefaction, the particles will be further apart. So we can write down, loudness does not affect the wavelength, so that the compressions and rarefaction still be in that place. So that's the first point, loudness does not affect the wavelength. But as loudness increases, the amplitude of the wave will increase. So for a sound wave, how the amplitude increases? So the particles at the compression will be closer together. So we can write, particles are closer together at compression and further apart at rarefaction. Part D, the wave passes into water. State and explain any change in the pattern of wavefront shown in figure 6.1. So when sound wave traveling into water, the first important point is the speed of sound wave will be greater, because water consists of lots of particles and sound wave is nothing but the vibration of particles. So more particles in water, so more vibration, so it will cause a higher speed. So that is the first point we can write down. Speed is greater in water than air, but the frequency will be always same. So speed will be greater, but frequency will be same. So what will happen to wavelength? As V is F lambda, F frequency cannot increase or decrease. So when velocity increase, automatically the wavelength of the wave will increase. So we can write, as the speed is greater, therefore the wavelength also will be greater, is greater. And one additional point, that is in water the sound wave will spread out more as more particles are there. So we can write, more spread out. Question number 7. Part A, figure 7.1 shows the position of a converging lens, its principal axis and an object O. So from the figure we can identify the position of a converging lens, its principal axis and object staying at O. Each principal focus on the lens is labeled F. There are two principal focus. On figure 7.1, draw a ray diagram to locate the position of image formed by the lens. Label the image I. So in order to draw a ray diagram, we can first draw a ray which is emerging parallel to the principal axis from the object. So a parallel ray, parallel to the principal axis. So the parallel rays, when it is passes through the lens, it will pass through the principal axis. So this parallel line, when it is passing, it will pass through the principal axis. One second, you should take a ruler and draw properly. Yes, so this is the first ray, a ray parallel to the principal axis which will pass through the principal focus. And the second ray, we can draw a ray which is passing through the center of the lens. So a ray which is passing through the center of the lens will always move straight without any deviation. So this is the second ray. So now by looking at these rays, we can understand that these rays are not intersecting because they are moving apart. So they are not going to intersect at any point. So we can extend these lines at the left side of the mirror in this way. So we will get a point where these two lines are intersecting. So you have to take a ruler and draw properly, extend properly. So when we extend here, I am going to extend the ray which is passing through the center to the other side. So we will get a line like this, and I'm going to extend the other ray also. So these are the two extended lines, and we can see now they are intersecting, and at this point the image will be formed where all the rays are intersecting, or we feel like intersecting. So this is the point where the image will be formed. At the left side of the lens, and we can label it as I, as mentioned in the question. It's mentioned to label the image I. Part B, describe the nature of the image I. So by looking at this image, we can understand by comparing the size of the object, the image is enlarged and upright because it's straight, not inverted. But we know the really the rays are not intersecting at any point. So we have just extended the rays to the other side. So this is not a real image but virtual image. So these are the three points we can write: enlarged and upright. You will get one mark. And for identifying virtual or real, you will get the second mark. So it's a virtual image. Part C, images formed by lenses sometimes have colored edges. Suggest a reason for this. So when a light ray passes through a prism or a lens, when it splits into different colors, then the reason is dispersion of light. So here also you can write due to dispersion. And how the dispersion happen? It's because different colors have different wavelength or different speeds in the medium, so they will get diffracted in different angle. So here, since it is one mark question, you just need to write is due to the dispersion in glass. Dispersion in glass. Okay, going to question number 8. Figure 8.1 shows a negatively charged conducting sphere. On figure 8.1, draw an electric field pattern around the sphere. So we should know that the electric field lines will always emerge from positive charge to negative charge, or the direction of field lines, electric field lines will be always towards negative charge. So since it is a sphere, the field lines will be radial. We should draw straight lines, uniform radial lines, that the separation between the lines should be uniform. And the arrow is very important. As we already mentioned, the direction of the electric field lines will be always pointing towards the negative charge. So here the sphere is negative, so this field line should direct towards the sphere, negatively charged sphere. If the sphere is positively charged, this arrow should be pointing outwards. Part B, the current in an electrical device is 0.21 ampere. Calculate the charge that flows during a 75 second period of time. So I and T, current and time is provided. We need to calculate charge Q. So we can use the equation which relate I, Q and T, and that is a very
important equation of current, that is current is rate of flow of charge. So I is equal to Q over T. In order to calculate Q, we can make the Q as a subject. So we'll get Q is I times T, where I is 0.21 times time is already given in seconds, that is 75. So just find the product. And in 2SF, the answer is 16 coulomb. Question number 9. Figure 9.1 shows a circuit containing an LED and two resistors in parallel, each of resistor R. The normal operating voltage of LED is 2.1 volt and normal current is 0.19 ampere. So they are provided with a circuit diagram which consists of an LED light emitting diode, this one, and two resistors connected parallel. Each of the resistors are having same value, which is R. The normal operating voltage of LED is 2.1 volt and the normal current is 0.1 ampere. Part A. The potential difference PD across the LED is measured with voltmeter. On figure 9.1, draw the symbol for this voltmeter connected to the circuit. So we need to connect a voltmeter in order to measure the voltage across the LED. So in order to measure the voltage across the LED, we should connect the voltmeter parallel to the LED or across the LED. So this is what you have to draw. Part 2. The current in the LED is measured with an ammeter. On figure 9.1, draw the symbol of this ammeter connected to the circuit. So ammeter should be always connected in series with the circuit. So we can connect the ammeter on the path, because the function of ammeter is measure the amount of current flowing through that path. So we should always connect the ammeter on the path, where the voltmeter you should not connect on the path, but we should connect across that component. We need to measure the voltage. Part B. Calculate the value of R when the LED is operating normally. So when the LED is operating normally, we have the voltage or voltmeter reading across the LED and the current value passing through that. And at that time, what will be the value of resistance R? So let's look at this circuit again. As the voltmeter reading or the voltage across the LED at normal condition is 2.1 volt. We can understand that the voltage across LED is 2.1 volt. Then what will be the voltage across this resistor? Combination of these two resistors. Voltage across these two parallel resistors will be the total voltage provided to the circuit by the cell is 3.7 volt. Out of 3.7 volt, the LED uses or consumes a voltage of 2.1 volt, which is already mentioned in the question. So out of 3.7, 2.1 volt is consumed by the LED. The remaining voltage will be consumed by the parallel combination of resistance. So the total voltage is 3.7. From this, 2.1 is consumed by the LED. So the remaining voltage, that is 1.6 volt, that will be the potential difference across these two parallel combination of resistors. So that means the voltage across the resistor, first resistor, is 1.6. Even the voltage across the second resistor will also be 1.6 volt, because the voltage across parallel paths will be always same. And we have the current passing through the LED in the normal case, which is given 0.19 ampere. That means the current here is 0.19 ampere. So this is the same current going to pass through the circuit. That is a current of 0.19 ampere. But when the current reaches here, it splits, and as both the resistor value equal, the current passing through these resistor will be divided equally, and this current will be half of 0.19, that is the total current flowing, half of this, and we will get 0.095 ampere. That means the current of 0.19 splits into equal halves, and a current of 0.095 is passing. When they reaches back to this junction, they will combine back again and add these two currents, and the current passing through this will be 1.919 again. Now, in order to calculate the resistance value, we can just concentrate at this resistor, where the voltage across this resistor we have 1.6 volt, and the current we have calculated as the current divides equally. The current passing through one single resistor is 0.095, and we can calculate R, because we have voltage across the resistor R, current passing through the resistor R, so we can find out R using the equation V is equal to IR. But it's 5 mark question, you should show all the workings here. So first of all, you can find the voltage across the parallel combination, that is the total voltage of the circuit 3.7 minus the voltage consumed across the LED, or the potential difference across LED, that is 2.1 volt. So we will get 1.6 volt, and we can find the current passing through a single resistor R is the total current flowing through the circuit, that is 0.19 over 2, and we will get 0.095 ampere. So we have I and V, so we can calculate the resistor value R using the equation R is equal to V over I, where voltage is 1.6 and current is 0.095. so we can substitute 1.6 over 0.095. So we will get 16.84, and into SF we can write 17. So 17 ohm is the answer. For electricity questions, we will have so many different ways to get an answer. Here also, this is not the only way. You can even find the combined resistance, and you can calculate the resistance value R. Still, you will get the correct answer. You just need to use the correct concept of electricity and the correct equations. You will get full marks. Question number 10, part A. A magnet and a coil are attached separately to a door and a door frame as shown in figure 10.1. The purpose of the arrangement is to activate a circuit connected to the LED indicator when the door is opening or closing. This will provide a visual indication that the door is being used. So as you can see in the figure, there is a magnet and a coil are attached separately to a door and a door frame as shown in the figure, and the coil is then connected to a LED. Going back to the question, initially the door is closed and then it is open. Part 1, explain why the indicator comes on and then goes off when the door is open. So it says that when the door is open and closed, the LED will glow. So we need to explain how the LED is working in this case. So here, the reason is electromagnetic induction. So when the door is closed, we know that the magnet is close to the coil, and the magnet will have magnetic field around it. These magnetic fields are linked with the coil. So whenever this door is closed, this is the case, the magnet is very much close to the coil and all the field lines around the bar magnet is linked or connected to the coil. But when we open the door, the magnet moves away so that the field lines also moves away. So initially the field lines were linked with the coil, as you can see it was linked with the coil, but when the door opens the field lines are moving away. So this movement of magnet relative to the coil produces an EMF in the coil, or an induced current will be there in the coil. As this magnet moves away, the number of field lines connected to the coil has reduced. This change in the field lines linked with the coil will cause a current that is known as induced current or induced EMF. So now there will be induced current in this coil, and this current will starts to pass through, and it will pass through the LED, which will cause the LED to glow. So we can write there is a movement of magnet relative to coil, or the number of field lines linked with the coil will change when the door opens as the magnet moves away from the coil, which will cause a induced EMF in the coil. So induces an EMF or current in the coil, which will cause the LED to glow. So the LED glows, but the magnet is more away from the coil, then there is no more field lines, so there will be no induced EMF. Then the LED will goes off. So we can write down light goes off when magnet no longer directly below the coil. Part 2, the door shuts. The indicator comes on more brightly but for a shorter time than it did it. Suggest and explain why this happened. So when we close the door also, we know that the same thing will happen. The magnet will come with the contact with the coil. So again the field lines connected to the or linked with the coil will increase. So this change in the field lines will cause a induced EMF. I will just show how it works. When you close the door, this magnet again going to closer to the coil, and now we can see more field lines are linked. So the number of field lines connected to the coil is keep increasing. This will cause a current. This is electromagnetic induction. So again there will be induced current, so that there will be a glow in LED, or LED will be switching on due to this induced current. But here LED brights more when we close the door, but the time taken was shorter. What could be the reason? So from this we can understand the current should be, or the induced current is greater in this case. That's why more brightness, but the time was less. And the reason is, if we close the door more quickly, the number of field lines linked with the coil will change quickly, so it will produce a higher current, because the induced EMF is actually depending on this equation is important. The induced EMF is change depending on the change in number of field lines linked with the coil over time. So by looking at the equation, we can understand that when the time is small, the induced EMF will be more, right? So when the door closes quickly, the time is less, so more induced EMF will be there. So we can write door closes more quickly than it was opened. So higher current in the LED. And in other words, we can write down the magnet moving for a shorter length of time. Magnet or door. So these are the 2 points we can write in order to score 2 marks. So this equation is important, that induced EMF, amount of induced EMF depending on changing number of field lines and the time. The more number of field lines are changing means more induced EMF, less time also causes more induced EMF. Part B, a circuit breaker is recommended for use with an electric lawnmower. State two reasons for this recommendation. So here you just need to write down the use of circuit breaker. So you can write any two reasons or uses of a circuit breaker. So the two uses are protect against electric shock, protect against overheating. There are some more uses for a circuit breaker, like quick response, avoids damage to lawnmower, etc. So you just need to write any two points. 11 part A. The circles shown in figure 11.1 represents three Gold nuclei. Three alpha particles are approaching the Gold nuclei. So here these circles represents Gold nuclei. So the charge of a nucleus is positive. So all these nucleus are having a positive charge. And as you can see, these alpha particles are approaching to this Gold nucleus. So what will happen to the path of these alpha particles? So let's look at each one. And the charge of an alpha particle is also positive. So we know that when two positive charged particles approach each other, they will ripple away. So here, this alpha particles, when it is smooth, it will ripple and it will deflect backwards. So we can put an arrow to indicate the direction. Now looking at the second alpha particles, it's not going directly to the positively charged nucleus, because you can see there is a difference or distance between the path of alpha particle and nucleus. So the deflection will be less, but still, instead of going straight, the alpha particle will deflect upward. So this will be the path of alpha particle. In the same way, the third alpha particle also, as it is moving straight, it was supposed to move straight, but the presence of a positively charged nucleus and the alpha particle itself positive, again it will deflect. So the new path will be something downward, but please make sure then it must be a straight line. After the deflection, it should continue to move in a straight line. So you should take a ruler and draw. Part B, a detector of radioactivity in a laboratory indicates an average of 16 counts per minute when no radioactive samples are present. The radioactive sample of half-life 1.5 days is placed close to the detector, which indicates a count rate of 208 counts per minute. So here it's mentioned that without the presence of any radioactive samples, the detector counts a 16 counts per minute, and it is due to the background radiation. That is the radiations from the surroundings without any sample. Now we have a radioactive sample which is having a half-life of 1.5 days. And with the presence of this sample, now the new reading or the new count on the detector is 208 counts per minute. So this count includes both, or this new count on the detector is because of the background radiation, which is 16 per minute, plus the radiation from the sample. So the total count is 208 counts per minute. And we need to calculate the count rate that is indicated 6 days later. So after 6 days, what will be the new count rate? So first we can calculate the count rate of the sample at the beginning. That is the total count rate, 208 but we have to subtract with background radiation, that is 16. So we will get 192. So this is the count rate only from the sample. Now we need to check how many half lives has gone through in 6 days. Has the half life period is 1.5 days. How many half lives are there in 6 days? So number of half life is equal to total time over half life. So the total time is 6 days over the half life is 1.5 days. So we will get four half lives. Now we have to calculate after four half lives what will happen to this count initially, which was 192. So we can write down new count after four half lives will be 192 times after one half life, it will become half of that value. After second half time, one more half of that value. Third half life, again the half of that value. And the fourth one, after fourth half life, again the half of that total value. So we can write down 192 times 1 over 16. So the new count from this sample will be 12. Now the detector will count a total of reading on detector will be the counts from the sample, that is 12 after 4 life period, half life we calculated, plus we have to count the background radiation which is mentioned 16 counts. So the total count rate will be 28. So 28 counts per minute. Part C, the waste from nuclear power stations includes the isotopes technetium 99, tin 126 and selenium 79. These isotopes are radioactive with half-life of many thousands of years. State 3 economic and environmental consequences of producing this waste. So we know that these wastes, nuclear or radioactive waste, are very dangerous for the environment and the people. So we have to keep it safely, which is very, very expensive. So we can write down some points, the importance to keep this waste safely and how it will cause or it will affect economically. So first point we can write, must be stored with shielding. Second point, must be transported this waste securely and with shielding. So definitely it will be expensive to store. So we can write expensive to store is the other point. Expensive not only to store but for transport also. So we can write expensive to store and transport. And another point, in case of accident, it will be danger to people as it emits high energy radioactive particles. So since it is 3 mark questions, 3 points are enough. Thanks for watching this video, and if you find this video useful, please like this video and subscribe my channel. Thank you.